Pujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Kritamastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namatarakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibhi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. Namasabhai, welcoming one and all to this series of Srimad Ramayana, which is titled as Ramayana, the legendary lesson of life values. By the grace of Acharyas, we tend to present the story of Ramayana, the entire Itihasa, in a series of 48 lectures, wherein each lecture would be having a title and a duration of about 15 to 20 minutes. Sage Valmiki is the author of the Ramayana, and he composed this Itihasa or epic because of the gracious blessings of the Lord. As we listen to the story of the Ramayana, we will find that something can be visualized in front of our eyes. Whenever we listen to any story, it's always better to contemplate on the content of the story so that the experience becomes complete and fulfilling. So, elders and greater deities have taught us how to visualize the Ramayana as we listen to the story. So, that becomes our first topic of discussion. In this series of 48, the first part which we are going to listen to today is titled as Visualize the Ramayana. The Ramayana is a story of the Prince Rama, the incarnation of Lord Narayana, who came down on this earth for a purpose. His story has been narrated in detail by Sage Valmiki such that the epic covers 24,000 shlokas, which have been divided into 7 khandas or 7 units. Each of these khandas or units convey a particular part of the story. As we listen to each khanda, we have to visualize a particular form of Lord Rama in front of us so that our experience becomes blissful. This form of visualization has been suggested and taught by Lord Paramashiva to his consort Parvati Devi, and this has been recorded in the Brahmanda Purana. So, as one listens to the story of each khanda, he is supposed to think about the Lord in a particular manner. He is supposed to visualize Lord Rama in a particular fashion. Now, we shall discuss how we should visualize the Lord when we are listening to stories from each of these khandas. As we discuss this, we'll also realize that we are going to go through a short pressy of the story of that khanda too. So essentially, we will get to listen to a short summary of the entire story of Ramayana today, and we'll be able to visualize the Ramayana too in this manner. So the first khanda or unit of Ramayana the first amongst the seven, is called as the Balakanda. And what does the Balakanda deal with? It deals with the story of how the city of Ayodhya was, how King Dasharatha was ruling over Ayodhya, and how he longed for a son and ultimately had four great sons, and how the childhood of Rama and his wedding went through. So this is a short précis of the Balakanda. So when we listen to these stories from the Balakanda in detail, we are supposed to contemplate on Lord Rama in a particular fashion. What fashion are we supposed to contemplate on him? It is said in the Brahmanda Purana, Kakapakshadharam Devam Vanamala Vibhushitam Shri Ramam Balakam Dhyayet Balakande Munishwara. When we listen to stories from the Balakanda, we should think of Lord Rama, we should visualize Lord Rama in front of our eyes, such that he was a young lad having a hairstyle called Kakapaksha. Kakapaksha Dharam Devam. The Kakapaksha hairstyle is very prevalent in these modern times. We can see men growing long locks, long hair which comes almost up to their shoulders. So that is the Kakapaksha hairstyle, where hair is grown by a young lad up to his shoulder length. It seems Lord Rama had such kind of hair as he was a young lad. So he had this Kakapaksha. So think of that Lord Rama who had the Kakapaksha hairstyle. And Vanamala Vibhushitam, who was adorned with Vanamala. Now Vanamala means a garland of flowers which was plucked from forests. Now, why is this being said? We need to understand that in the Balakanda, Lord Rama went with sage Vishwamitra into the forest to defeat a lot of demons. So, as he went to the forest, Vishwamitra very fondly plucked flowers from the forest, made garlands out of that, and would give it to the Lord and see him adorn it and get happiness from that. So, the devotion of Vishwamitra is being shown here, where it is said that we should contemplate on Lord Rama wearing the Vanamala when we listen to stories from the Balakanda. So, think of Lord Rama who had the hairstyle called Kakapaksha and who was adorned with Vanamala. Vanamala Vibhushitam. That young lad Rama should be the object of contemplation as we listen to stories from Balakanda. Shri Ramam Balakam Dhyayet Balakande Munishwara. Fine. So when we listen to stories from the Balakanda, this should be what we should look at. Next, we move to the next Kanda or unit, the second unit called as the Ayodhya Kanda. Now in the Ayodhya Kanda, Lord Rama lived with Sita Devi in Ayodhya in a very happy manner for quite some time, for about 12 years it is said. And he was that obedient son of Dasharatha who gave up all his comfort of the palace just to fulfill his father's promise. So these aspects are spoken of highly in the Ayodhya Kanda. So when we listen to stories from the Ayodhya Kanda, how should we contemplate on the Lord? Sita Devi Yutam Veeram Sarva Bhushana Bhushitam Pitribhaktam Harim Dhyaye Ayodhya Kanda Uttame. We should think of the Lord as the one who is always associated with Sita Devi. Sita Devi Yutam Veeram. And this Lord Rama, as he existed in Ayodhya, he was a prince and he was a crown prince. So he was adorned with all finesse and jewelry. So that beautiful form of Rama, who was adorned with jewels, should be our object of contemplation. That showed how fond the entire city of Ayodhya was of Rama. So they always wanted to look at him as the most pampered and decorated person. So we should also think of him in that fashion. Sarvabhushana Bhushitam. We should think of him as the one adorning all possible kind of jewels that a king or a prince could adorn, and who was always associated with Sita Devi. Such a lord, such a son, such a prince decided to give up all his comfort and all his pampering only to listen to his father's words. So that aspect of Rama should be contemplated upon when we listen to stories of the Ayodhya Kanda. So it is said, Pitribhaktam Harim Dhyayet. Think of that Hari, that Lord Rama, who was a Pitribhakta, a devotee of his father. He listened to his father as a devotee would listen to the Lord. So think of that Lord Rama when you listen to stories from the Ayodhya Kanda. Fine. Next, we move on to the third unit or the third Kanda called as the Aranya Kanda. As you listen to the stories from the Aranya Kanda, which is also sometimes called the Aranya Kanda, how should we contemplate on the Lord? The Aranya Kanda tells us about stories of Rama in Aranya or in the forest. So, how was the form of the Lord in the forest? It was like the form of sages. So it is said that think of Lord Rama who lived like a sage in the forest. Jatilam Chiravasanam Dandakaranyavasinam Munivesha Dharam Dhyayet Aranye Kanda Uttame. Think of Lord Rama who adorned the robes of sages. Munivesha Dharam Dhyayet, it is said. And what is this Munivesha? Or the form of sages, the adornment of sages. It is nothing but wearing jatilam chiravasanam, wearing bark garments and living in the forest like a forest dweller. Dandakaranyavasinam. He gave up all his comfort, all his happiness and all kinds of pampering that he had in the palace and came and lived as simply as the ascetics in the forest. So that simplicity of the Lord is to be contemplated upon when we listen to stories from the Aranya Kanda. Next, we move on to the fourth Kanda or unit called as the Kishkindha Kanda. In the Kishkindha Kanda, the Lord befriended the monkey king Sugriva. And thus, all the monkey clan became the Lord's friends. This shows us that the Lord never looked at high and low. He associated with one and all with compassion. Anybody who would come to him seeking for anything was granted all that he wanted, and above all, he granted himself to them. So when we listen to the stories of the Kishkindha Kanda, we should think of the Lord as the monkey king Sugriva's friend. Sugrivatyutam Shrisham Bhasmangavrita Vishwaram Maheshwaram Ivadhyayet Kishkindha Kanda Uttame. It is said that the Lord was surrounded by the monkeys in the Kishkindha Kanda. We should think of him as surrounded by the monkeys in the Kishkindha Kanda. And how is this like? This is like Maheshwara or Paramashiva being surrounded by his kinsmen or the Ganas, the Shiva Ganas. It is said that Parameshwara is always surrounded by the Shiva Ganas, and thus the Lord was also surrounded by the monkey clan all through the Kishkindha Kanda. So we should think of his friendship with the monkeys and his compassion towards everybody as we listen to the stories of the Kishkindha Kanda. Next, the fifth Kanda or the fifth unit is called as the Sundara Kanda. The Sundara Kanda is a very beautiful Kanda. The name itself suggests so. Sundara is beautiful. So, we think of the beautiful form of the Lord when we listen to stories of the Sundara Kanda. This Kanda is made very beautiful by the beautiful service of Hanuman to Lord Rama. So, we should think of the Lord who is being served by Hanuman as we listen to the stories of the Sundara Kanda. It is said, Chandrabimba Samakaram Vanchitartha Pradayakam Hanumat Sevitam Dhyayet Sundare Kanda Uttame. When we listen to stories of the Sundara Kanda, we should think of that Lord who was as beautiful as the moon, Chandra Bimba Samakaram, and who was served by Hanuman, Hanumat Sevitam Dhyayet. And this Lord is the one who grants everybody everything. Vanchitartha Pradayakam. It is said that the Lord would grant anything to anybody who came to him with sincerity. And this is shown in the story of the Sundara Kanda. Because the Sundara Kanda tells us the story of a crow who was granted asylum by the Lord despite the fact that he did a great sin which was really unpardonable. We would listen to the story in detail when the time comes during this series. But this part of the story, the Sundara Kanda, shows us how the Lord is a Vanchitartha Pradayaka, or the one who grants all desirous fruits to everybody. So thus, we contemplate on the Lord who was served by Hanuman as we listen to the stories of the Sundara Kanda. Next comes the sixth unit, or the sixth Kanda, called as the Yuddha Kanda. Yuddha Kanda is that phase where Lord Rama defeated Ravana, and that was the main mission of his avatara as Rama. Doing this, he did away with all the anxiety of the Devas, starting from Brahma, and he also got reunited with Sita Devi. So all these aspects are to be thought of when we listen to the stories from the Yuddha Kanda. Ravanadi Vihantaram Brahma Rudradi Sevitam Sita Devi Yutam Yuddhe Ramam Dhyayet Hritam Bhuje. When we listen to stories of the Yuddha Kanda, we think of that Lord who slew Ravana, Ravanadi Vihantaram, and who was praised by Brahma and Rudra, Brahma Rudradi Sevitam, all Devas for that matter. And then we should think of him who got reunited with Sita Devi. Sita Devi Yutam Yuddhe Ramam Dhyayet Tambhuje. Thus, we should think of the Pattabhisheka form, or the coronated form of the Lord along with Sita, as we listen to the story of the Yuddha Kanda. Then comes the final Kanda, or the seventh Kanda, the seventh unit, called as the Uttara Kanda. Uttara Kanda narrates a lot of stories related to the Ramayana and what happened in the Rama Rajya, or the rule by Rama. So we essentially think of that Lord who was above everyone and who was praised by the sages when we listen to the stories from Uttara Kanda. Agastyadi Munim Stutyam Vanchitartha Pradayakam Sarvadevo Tamam Dhyaye Uttare Kanda Uttame. So we think of that Lord Rama who was praised by sages like Agastyadi Munim Stutyam, and who was the Lord of Lords, Sarvadevo Tamam Dhyayet, and who is also capable of granting all that we desire. Vanchitartha Pradayakam. This Rama we should think of as we listen to stories of the Uttara Kanda. Now, we have seen seven different forms of visualization as we listen to seven Kandas from the Ramayana. Now, when we listen to the story of the Ramayana, we'll realize that it's not that we always talk about story of a single Kanda only. Stories could be interrelated too. So, if we are listening to interrelated stories from different Kandas or different units, are we supposed to shift our object of contemplation or visualization every time? Is it possible to do that? So, people thought for a while and thought that if we have a foolproof dhyanam, or a foolproof object of contemplation, scene of contemplation, which could be thought of when we listen to anything related to the Ramayana, any story related to the Ramayana, then it would be better. So thinking thus, a foolproof dhyana shloka or contemplation shloka or visualization poem has been composed
which tells us how we should visualize the Lord when we listen to any story of the Ramayana. Which is that shlokam? The shlokam is Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Virasane Susthitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyav Param Vyakhyantam Bharata Divihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam. Now this shloka or this visualization is the best because it acts as an elixir. It tells us that Ramayana is a medicine which can save us from all evils. So Ramayana is an elixir. How it is an elixir, we'll get to know in the next part of the series.
Pujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Virasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyav Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. Namasabhaye.
In the series of the Ramayana, titled as Ramayana, the Legendary Lesson of Life Values, we now commence with the second part, titled as Ramayana, the Eternal Elixir. In the previous part, we saw how to visualize the Ramayana. The great epic Ramayana, composed of 24,000 shlokas, which are distributed into 7 units or 7 khandas, is to be visualized by us as we listen to the story. As we listen to each of these khandas, we try to visualize a particular picture of Lord Rama which relates to the stories of that khanda. Now, as we saw, when we listen to the story, it may so happen that stories from different khandas are narrated to establish some connectivity or to make understanding more easier. So, it would be better if we have a single picture as the object of contemplation as we listen to any story from the Ramayana. So, what is this picture that we have to visualize as we listen to anything from the Ramayana? When we listen to the Ramayana, any story from the Ramayana, we should try to have this particular picture in front of us. Which is this picture? That has been said in the Dhyana Shloka of the Ramayana, which we saw in the previous part and which we shall repeat now and try to understand the meaning. Vaidehi sahitam suradrumatale haime mahamantape madhye pushpakamasane manimaye virasane susthitam agrevachayati prabhanjanasute tatvam munibhyav param vyakhyantam bharatadibihi parivritam ramam bhajeshyamalam. We always must contemplate that Lord Rama who is associated with Sita Devi, also known as Vaidehi. Vaidehi Sahitam, the shloka begins. Why is this important? Because as we shall be seeing in the stories of the Ramayana, anywhere where Sita Devi was present beside the Lord, he never indulged in destruction or samhara.
He never destroyed even a foe of his when Sita Devi was around. When he was in the company of Sita Devi, Rama was never involved in anything related to putting an end to a person or a demon. On the contrary, if we see when and all the Lord did Samhara, like he did Samhara of Tataka, of Subahu, of Vali, of Khara, of Dushana, of Kumbhakarna and of Ravana. And during all these times, Sita Devi was not present beside him physically. That is, it could not be perceived by the eyes of the onlookers at that time. So it is said that if we want the grace of the Lord completely and if we want him to pardon us for all our mistakes, we should ensure that we contemplate upon him as associated with Sita Devi or Vaidehi. Vaidehi Sahitam. Now, along with this Vaidehi, the Lord is seated in a beautiful mantapa. Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape. Haime Mahamantape refers to a vast golden mantap or a vast golden court. This golden court has a beautiful simhasana or throne placed within it. And we should visualize Lord Rama being seated on this simhasana. Madhye pushpakamasane manimaye veerasane susthitam. It seems this mantapa is decorated with all kinds of manis or adornments or ornaments. And this simhasana is adorned with flowers. Madhye pushpakamasane, it is said. And seated on this beautiful flower throne, which is present amidst a decorated mantapa, Lord Rama takes on the posture of Veerasana. What is Veerasana? Veerasana is that posture in which one folds his right leg and lets down his left leg. So, Lord Rama is seated in this position called Veerasana along with Sita Devi on a flower-laden throne which is present amidst a decorated mantapa. So, this is how we should visualize Lord Rama as we listen to any story of Ramayana. Now, surrounding Lord Rama, what is happening? That should also be present in our vision, it is said. How is the scenario surrounding Lord Rama? Agre vachayati prabhanjanasute. In front of Lord Rama, this son of the wind, Prabhanjanasuta, Hanuman, is reading the Ramayana continuously. Agre vachayati prabhanjanasute tattvam munibhyah param vyakhyantam. And the Ramayana, which is being read by Hanuman, is being commented upon by Lord Rama himself. Hanuman is reading the Ramayana and Lord Rama is enjoying listening to it and also giving an explanation for it. And everybody surrounding it are enjoying. Who are the ones who are enjoying this beautiful story of the Ramayana? Bharata adibihi parivritam ramam bhaje shyamalam. The entire clan of Rama, starting from Bharata, are enjoying the Ramayana. Now, this list is a big one, the clan of Rama. It includes the brothers of Rama, like Bharata, Shatrughna, Lakshmana, Guha, Sugriva, Vibhishana. It includes the monkey kinsmen, like Angada and Jambavan. It includes great sages, like Agastya, Valmiki, Vasishta, Shatananda. Like this, the entire Parivara of Rama, the family of Rama, the clan of Rama is enjoying listening to this Rama. And that dark-hued Lord Rama, Ramam bhaje shyamalam, is to be thought of, it is said. Why should we think of the Lord as the dark-hued one? This is because The dark-hued color, the Shyamala color of the Lord, reminds us of his compassion. So, we think of that dark-hued, compassionate Lord Rama, who is beautifully seated on a flower throne along with Sita Devi, which is present inside a Mahamantapa, a golden Mahamantapa. And that mantapa is filled with the clan of Rama, starting from Bharata, who are all listening to the meaning of the Ramayana as the Lord is conveying it and as the verses of the Ramayana are being read out by the Lord's favorite devotee Hanuman. Now in this entire shloka, all the words have been explained except for one, which is that it is said, Vaidehi sahitam suradrumatale haime mahamantape. The Lord is seated inside a golden mantapa which is present below a particular tree called Suradruma. Suradruma means the celestial tree, Kalpaka Vriksha. The Kalpaka Vriksha is that tree which grants all kinds of fruits to the one seated beneath it. So if one happens to sit below the Kalpaka tree and wish for something, the wish will immediately come true. Now here, the Kalpaka tree is being referred to in this shloka. Was there a Kalpaka tree actually present in this scenario? If we go to actually find out, the answer is no. There was not any physical Kalpaka tree present under which there was a mantapa and under which there was a throne and the Lord was seated in it. There was no physical tree present. Then why is a tree being spoken about in the shloka? The answer is given by Ashukavi Sarvabhauma Srinidhi Swami in his Manju Ramayana. In the Dhyana Shloka of Srimad Ramayana, the Suradrumatala or the Kalpaka tree which is being spoken about is nothing but the Ramayana itself. The story of Ramayana itself is like the celestial Kalpaka tree, which is a grantor of all boons. And from where did this Kalpaka tree emerge? Srinidhi Swami very beautifully explains with his poetic excellence that it so happened that a seed was thrown in the ocean by the Lord and a tree emerged out from the ocean. It is well known that the celestial Kalpaka tree emerged out from the milky ocean as the Devas and Asuras churned it out. So also a celestial tree called the Ramayana emerged out of the ocean of mercy of the Lord. And the seed which was thrown into this ocean was none other than Maricha. Now we'll get to know as we listen to the story of the Ramayana that the Lord went ahead with sage Vishwamitra to slay the demons who were troubling the sages who were performing penance. The Lord Rama slew Tataka and her son Subahu. There was another son of Tataka known as Maricha, whom the Lord did not slay at this time. Instead, he whirled Maricha and threw him 100 yojanas away into the sea. Why did the Lord choose to throw this Maricha into the sea? And why did he not slay him at that time? The answer is, had the Lord slew Maricha right at that time, then this Maricha would not have appeared as a golden deer later, and that would not have caused the abduction of Sita, which ultimately led to slaying of Ravana, and thus the entire story of Ramayana. So it seems that the Lord threw away this Maricha like a seed into the ocean so that the entire story of Ramayana grows out from that seed and becomes like a celestial tree which grants all kinds of fruits. This is very beautifully explained in this shloka of Manju Ramayana, where Swami says, Katham nijam kalpalatam jananam vistarayanesha raghupraviraha marichamenam kilabijamasyaha samvapayamasa samudramadhye. The seed called Maricha was thrown by the Lord into the sea so that the kalpalata or the celestial tree-like creeper Ramayana comes out of it and grants us all kinds of fruits. Yes, the Ramayana is a grantor of all fruits, it is said. Each sarga of the Ramayana is supposed to grant a particular fruit. For instance, we will see how a few sargas grant us some fruits. Before that, let's try to understand what a sarga means. We just said before that the 24,000 shlokas of the Ramayana are divided into 7 units called the khandas. Each khanda contains chapters called sargas. And each of these sargas are known to yield particular fruits. It is said that if one wishes to get married, then he reads the sarga which tells us about Sita's wedding, the Sita Kalyana sarga. If one wants children or progeny, then he reads the Payasotpatti sarga, which is the chapter which describes how the divine nectar or payasam came out from the sacrificial fire which was lit by the sages for King Dasharatha. If one wants to have a safe delivery, if one wants to deliver her progeny safely, then one reads the Ramavatara Sarga. If one needs good character for their children, then they must read the Sargas from the Ayodhya Kanda, which describe the character of Lord Rama. If one is going on a good errand or a virtuous errand and he wants it to get completed without any obstacles, he reads Sargas 21 to 25 of the Ayodhya Kanda. If one needs better finances, he must read the 15th Sarga of the Sundara Kanda. If one wants all relatives to remain together, he must read the 36th Sarga of the Sundara Kanda. And so on. Each Sarga is known to give a particular type of fruit, and it is for sure that if one reads the Ramayana, then all kinds of virtues comes to him. Now, this is not it. The Ramayana is such a giver of goodness and a grantor of boons that it can even revive back or resurrect back a person who is in the last stage of life. There is this famous story about the Kamba Ramayana. Kamban was a Tamil poet who wrote the Ramayana in a very beautiful manner in chaste Tamil poetry. And he wanted his work to be validated by great scholars. So he went to Chidambaram, where a lot of Shaiva Dikshitas known for their poetic skills were there. And he wanted them to listen to his poetry and give acceptance. But somehow these Shaiva Dikshitas, who were about 3,000 in number, were not too interested in listening to Kamban. And because of this, they did not pay heed to what he was saying. They tried to do away with him, saying that unless all of us assemble at one place and listen to your work, we cannot give you acceptance. And so it happened that Kamban waited for a long period of time for all these people to assemble in one place, but it never happened. And Kamban had traveled from a faraway place to Chidambaram to get this approval. And he was soon running out of both patience and his provisions which he had carried along to stay here. So one night he was absolutely frustrated with whatever was happening, and he appealed to the Lord Govindaraja of Chidambaram and said that, "Oh Lord, it seems that people are not going to come and listen to my poetry at all. So it's better that I stop pursuing them, and I might as well give up this poetry of mine and myself too. And in this frame of mind, he slept off near the temple that day. That night, Kamban had a dream wherein the Lord told him to go to a cremation ground nearby. And he said, your purpose would be achieved. Kamban was surprised at this call of the Lord, but he decided to listen and he went to that cremation ground and he found all the 3000 Dikshitas present there. The reason why they had assembled there was a young lad from their clan had passed away, unfortunately. Now, looking at this sad plight, Kamban came and said to all of them that now that I see all of you together, I think I should read out my poetry. People there are startled and they say, don't you have any sense? We are all in a sad state of mind wherein a young lad has passed away and you want us to listen to your poetry now. To this, Kamban says, do not worry. I am sure that this poetry of mine, the Ramayana, will bring back your lad to life. That will really resurrect this young boy. So saying, he read out one verse from his Ramayana, the verse in which Garuda came to save the monkeys from the Nagapasha. And as he read this single verse, that boy who had been bitten by a serpent and had become dead actually got resurrected and came back to life. This is the power of the Ramayana, and so it is called as the eternal elixir. It is indeed an elixir because when Sita Devi had almost decided to end her life tortured by Ravana, the song that resurrected her was the Ramayana, which was sung by Hanuman. Thus, the Ramayana is a Kalpaka Vriksha, which is a grantor of all boons, including the boon of resurrection. And so, the Ramayana is called as the eternal elixir. So, from the next part, let us start enjoying this elixir and taking it into our souls so that we are resurrected from this mundane world or samsara.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Kritamastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurnalochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam.
Srimad Ramayana, Part 3. The Dacoit Who Became a Sage. In this series of Srimad Ramayana, we have been listening to how the Ramayana is to be visualized when we listen to the story, and how the story itself is a grantor of all boons and like an elixir which can save us from great perils. Now we will move on to the actual story of the Ramayana. The author of the Ramayana is the famous sage Valmiki. Today we are going to see the story of this sage Valmiki. It so happened that there was a hunter who turned into a dacoit by the name Ratnakar. This Ratnakar was not able to make ends meet by hunting. So he started making small thefts of passers-by in the forest. And slowly he became a big dacoit. Ratnakar had a family which consisted of his parents, his wife and children. And his only motive was to keep all of them happy.
And in order to keep them happy, he wanted to earn more money. And he thought resorting to any means to keep them happy is not wrong. So he resorted to this means of dacoity and he became a dacoit. Once, when he was looking around for passers-by in the forest, it so happened that the Saptarishis, the seven great sages, passed by in the forest. Now, as the Saptarishis passed by, this Ratnakar stopped them, as was his routine, and tried to rob them of their belongings. Now, they being sages, they did not have many belongings, but they had something to tell this dacoit. They asked Ratnakar, "For what are you doing this?" Ratnakar had a ready answer. He said, "I am doing it to keep my family happy." So the sages asked, "Fine, do you understand that you are resorting to a wrong means to keep your family happy?" Ratnakar said, "Yes, I am aware. I know that robbing somebody of their belongings is not a meritorious act. It is definitely going to incur sin on me." So the sages asked him back in turn, "Do you think that your family, who is enjoying all your earnings, will also take part in bearing the fruits of this sin incurred by this robbery?" Ratnakar said, "Of course, why not? The family who is supporting me when I am giving them good things, when I am giving them all enjoyment, why will they not support me when I am in danger or when I am in trouble? If I am going to fall in trouble because of these sins that I am committing for their sake, obviously they will also take part, or they will also share the burden of the sins that I am going to experience, the fruit of the sins that I am going to experience." To this the sages said, "See Ratnakar, you are saying this, but are you sure that your family will support you? Why don't you just ask them and confirm?" Ratnakar replied, "Fine, I don't have a doubt. Nevertheless, because you people are saying so, let me get their consent regarding this matter and I'll come back and tell you whether they will share my sins or not. But then, why are you telling me to do this? My job is currently robbery. I want to take your belongings and go. But now you have diverted my thoughts by your speech and you're sending me home to ask something. Why at all should I do this? Please give me your belongings and get away," he said. The sages said, "No, we'll surely hand over whatever we have to you. But then, we just want an answer for this. We want you to find the answer for this question for sure. It should not be your assumption that your family is going to support you when you're in trouble. Why don't you just find out for your own self and be satisfied? And we would also be happy knowing the answer. See, we being sages, you can trust us that we will stick to our word and we'll stay here till you come back. And then after you get your answer, you're free to do whatever you wish to with us." Somehow, the impactful talk of the sages made Ratnakar listen to them and go back to his family and ask them. He went to his father first and he said that, "See, some great sages came and told me that I am incurring a lot of sin because of this robbery. And as you people are enjoying whatever I am getting out of the robbery, I suppose you people will also share the burden of sins that I am going to experience as a result of this robbery." He asked this to his father and his father's immediate reply was, "See, what you are doing and what you are saying is absolutely not right. Because as your father, I taught you our clan's profession, that is hunting. You chose not to be a hunter but to become a dacoit. And now you are asking me whether I will bear the fruits of your robbery. Why should I? I never taught you to become a robber. You became a robber by choice. So obviously I am not going to share the burden of your sins by becoming a robber. If you say that I am enjoying the fruits of your robbery, I would not consider it as fruits of robbery but as your duty towards me. As a son, you are supposed to support me in my old age. And you're doing so. How you are supporting is your business. I have nothing to do with it. This was the reply of his father. Ratnakar was taken aback. But then he thought, okay, probably my father is a little upset because I did not do what he wanted. He wanted me to be a hunter only. But I wanted to keep my family comfortable. So I turned to a robber and he's unhappy with that. So fine, he let his father alone and he went to his mother. As soon as he went to his mother said, oh my son, you've come back from the forest so tired. Why don't you come and have food? Ratnakar said, Ma, please wait. I have something to ask you before I eat. So she said, what do you want, son? Please tell me. Do you want something special? I'll make it for you. Then Ratnakar said, no, Ma, I have a serious question. What is that? He asked back the same question. Will you bear the burden of my sins as you are enjoying the fruits of the robbery that I'm doing? To which the mother said, see, son, what you are expecting is not fair. As a son, you are doing something for us and we are very grateful to you for what you are doing. But how you are doing is absolutely your cup of tea and your choice. So the means that you have chosen to keep us happy is not something that we are connected with. I am very pleased and satisfied with you as my son. But what you are doing to keep me happy is not what I have taught you to do or is not something that I can be concerned about. What I am concerned about is my way of keeping you happy. I can give you food. I can keep you comfortable. That's all that I can do. If you ask me whether I am going to share the burden of your sins, my answer would also be, sorry to say, but no. Now, Ratnakar was more troubled. He did not expect this answer from his mother. He thought his mother would be by him, come what may. But his mother too had the same answer as his father. Then Ratnakar went with a troubled mind to his wife. And he asked her, see, you are my life partner. You share all my joys and sorrows. You're supposed to be with me through thicks and thins. So I suppose at least you will be with me to share my burden of sins because of this robbery. To which the wife said, this is extremely unexpected of you. It is your duty as my husband to support me and our children. It is your duty to earn for the family and keep us comfortable. Now, performing your duty is something that you have to take care of only by yourself. How do you think I can come and share your burden there to do your duty? What if you're doing your duty towards us, you better do it perfect and don't have any expectations from me to share that duty. I am doing my duty as a wife at home. I'm taking care of your parents and your children. That is my duty I'm doing. Your duty is to earn for the family that you are doing. Now, in my share of duties, if I have any problems, I have to face it. Similarly, if in your share of your duty, you have problems, it is your headache to face it. How do you expect me to come and share it? Ratnakar was completely shattered listening to his wife. He really did not expect his partner not to share his burden. Then he thought there was no use asking his little children about sharing the burden of sins. They would not even understand. So with a heavy heart, he went back to the sages. And he said, he asked them with a troubled mind, see, I was earning for my family. I thought it was not wrong to do anything under the sun to keep them happy. But they do not think like that for me. They are not reciprocating my feelings. That is so sad. I do not want to do this anymore. I understand I have incurred a lot of sin by being a robber all this while. And I do not want to continue with this miserable life. Please save me, O great sages. Saying so, he folded his hands and stood in front of them. The sages took pity on him and said, see, there is this magic mantra called as the Ramanama, the name of Rama. If you keep reciting Rama, 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 then you can be saved from this trouble. Now, Ratnakar tried to repeat back the name Rama. It is said, unfortunately, he did not get that name in his mouth. He was not able to utter the word Rama. So much was his sin that the Rama Nama refused to come on his mouth because of that. But the sages took compassion on him. They said, O Ratnakar, you are well aware of the names of trees in the forest. So they took him near a tree and they asked him, what is the name of this tree? Ratnakar was a Tamilian, so he said, this tree is named as Maramaram. Maramaram is the name of a tree. Mara is the name of that tree. So they said, you keep reciting the name of this tree, Mara, and repeat it. Mara, 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 Mara. Like this, the Mara, 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 Mara became Rama, 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 Rama. And thus, he started reciting the Ramanama with great devotion. Such was his devotion that nothing around him bothered him. With so much concentration and commitment, this Ratnakar started reciting the Ramanama, thinking that he was saying the name of a tree. But he believed that the sages gave him a mantra which would save him. That belief made him have a lot of conviction. And he kept on reciting for years together, such that there was an ant hill built on him. Ant started building a hill on him, covering his entire body. And an ant hill is called as Valmika in Sanskrit. So, the one inside a Valmika came to be known as Valmiki. This ant hill covered him so much that nobody knew that there was a sage under it. Then Varuna Deva decided to bring this sage out to light to the world, and so he poured rain on him, and thus this Valmika or the ant hill melted away and the sage came out. Now this Ratnakar has transformed into a sage. The Dacoit has become a sage, and Ratnakar came out as Valmiki from the Valmika as Varuna poured rain over him. This Valmiki was a purified soul now, and he came to be known as Prachetasa, the one who was saved by Varuna, because Varuna redeemed him out of the anthill. Now there's one more anecdote connected with this context. It is said that in his previous janma, Valmiki was the son of Varuna Deva, and he was playing around the ashrama of Rishi Narada when Narada Maharishi was explaining the Ramayana to his students. This son of Varuna, also known as Prachetasa, the son of Varuna is also Prachetasa, the one saved by Varuna is also Prachetasa. So this son of Varuna was playing around that hermitage and he was making a lot of noise which disturbed sage Narada. And because of that, Narada pronounced a curse on him, saying that he should become a Dacoit. And that is the reason why he became Ratnakar the Dacoit in his next janma. But Varuna was very disturbed by this. He went and asked sage Narada that, see, whatever said and done, the Ramayana has fallen on the ears of my son as he was playing around your hermitage. And listening to the Ramayana, after listening to the Ramayana, if he is going to receive a curse like this, then it doesn't seem right. That is not good for the glory of the Ramayana itself. So please, O sage, save my son, said Varuna. At that time, Narada said, do not worry. By this very son of yours, the Ramayana will come to light to the entire world. He will propagate the Ramayana in this world in his next janma. And because of that, this Valmiki became the one who actually authored the Ramayana in his next janma. Not only this, sage Narada also very compassionately told him that he would himself come and teach the Ramayana to this son of Varuna in that janma as Valmiki. And that's exactly what happened. Now let's come back to the story of Ratnakar, who became Valmiki and who came out of that Valmika or anthill. This Valmiki was a purified soul now, and he was living the life of an ascetic. And this was the time of Lord Rama's rule on the earth. So he knew about Lord Rama and his greatness. But he had certain doubts about who exactly was the one having great qualities. Was it Lord Rama or was it anybody else? Like this, he was a little troubled in mind. With this troubled mind, he was walking along the path of his hermitage when sage Narada appeared in front of him. Now sage Narada has told him that he will be receiving the Upadesha of the Ramayana in this Janma. So as a prelude to that, sage Narada appeared in front of him, and this troubled Valmiki asked sage Narada a few questions, and this is how the Valmiki Ramayana begins. The first shloka of the Valmiki Ramayana is Tapasvadhyaya niratam tapasvi vagvidam varam naradam paripaprachha Valmikir muni pungavam. The troubled Valmiki asked the great sage Narada a few questions. He asked him 16 questions. He asked him questions about the one having 16 qualities. Konvasmin sampratam loke gunavan kascha viryavan dharmajnyascha kritajnyascha satyavakyo dhadavrataha. He started asking him, who in this contemporary world is gunavan, the qualityful one? And saying so, he listed 16 qualities that he wanted to know about. In answer to these questions, sage Narada told him that it is none other than Lord Rama having these qualities. And in the process of telling him how Rama had these qualities, he narrated the entire Ramayana to him in gist, as a short pressi. Listening to this, Valmiki felt very blessed and he went away. Now, Valmiki was destined to give this Ramayana to the world. But till now, his soul had been cleansed by penance, but he was not actually well read, in the sense that he was not the one who went to a hermitage and learned the Shastras or reading and writing, etc. But he had listened to the whole Ramayana from Narada. So now, how was he to compose verses and propagate this in the world? It so happened that Valmiki Bhagavan was walking along the side of his hermitage. He saw a pair of forest cranes very happily involved in each other's company. And it so happened that a hunter suddenly killed one of the cranes. Valmiki was so overwhelmed by this sight that he really felt for the cranes, and his feeling made him pronounce a curse on that hunter who killed these two cranes. And the curse came out in the form of a shloka. He said, Manishada pratishtham tva magama shashvati samaham yat kauncha mithuna deka mavadhi kama mohitam. May you never have peace of mind, O hunter, who separated the cranes who were involved with each other in passion. That's the meaning of this verse. But this verse, which came out as a curse, was actually set to perfect poetic meter. Valmiki was surprised with himself because he did not expect himself to pronounce a curse, and he did not expect himself to compose a shloka too. He was troubled in mind that anything that came from him in the form of a verse or a shloka happened to be a curse in the beginning. So he was troubled. To ease out his trouble, Brahmadeva appeared in front of him and said that, do not worry. This particular phrase that you have said is a shloka by itself, and this only proves that you are somebody who can compose beautiful shlokas like this, and do not think that this is a curse that you have pronounced on the birds. It's only a reflection of your compassion towards fellow beings. Not only that, your verse has started with the word Ma, and Ma refers to Lakshmi Devi, which is only a sign of auspiciousness for you to start composing. So, go ahead and compose the entire Ramayana in this very meter. Saying so, Brahmadeva blessed sage Valmiki so that he could compose 24,000 shlokas and make the story of Ramayana reach the world. This was the episode of
a dacoit becoming a sage. Now we shall further listen to the story of the Ramayana in the next part.